Our journey through nationhood is beset with challenges that touch on insecurity, inadequate or lackluster healthcare delivery, labor disputes, electoral fraud, agitations for self-determination, lack of accountability, excessive corruption, and economic failure, amongst several others. Insecurity particularly seems to be redefining our socio-political space.
We have fought insecurity to the level that everybody can say, look, we are not happy. We are not saying, and there's no state that can talk about no crime. Development itself brings crime. So for me, that we've been able to fight insecurity to the level we are today is a major project for me.
In the first 6 weeks of 2021, for instance, no fewer than 1,525 persons were killed across the country, according to a Vanguard newspaper investigation and data obtained from the Nigeria Security Tracker, NST, published 1st March 2021.
Most of the state government are taking action, and we are fighting, and we are actually getting, you know, some of the security points where we fight these people. In Nasarawa State, for instance, you know, just last year, we went into a place called Utu. We were able, Mr. President assisted us to get a joint operation of the Air Force, the Army, the Police, the Navy, the Vigilante, you know, that we have civil defense. And then they all came, you know, some of them across from Kogi State, some of them from Nasarawa State. And when we attacked, so many people were killed. We took children, women and children, close to 1,000, you know, before we started sending them to that. So that's the worst you can do to anybody. It's worse than calling anybody a terrorist.
The response from the government has been intense, but the impact is not felt by all. And in various forms, citizens have been half-hearted in their show of appreciation.
Operation White Stoke, they've done well in terms of curtailing general criminality, not just the bandits, not just the Fulani herdsmen, not just the kidnapping activities here in Benue State, armed robbery and other forms of criminal activities, cultism and all that. They've been very supportive and they have done well. I must commend them. Since the inception, they have done well. But the challenge is truly they are overwhelmed. They're overwhelmed in the sense that the manpower is not enough, the equipment is not enough, and of course, other logistics that would have helped. On our part, with all the difficulties, but we try to support them, but it has not been easy.
Individual governors in their respective states have taken on the challenge headlong. It is particularly worthy of note that the Nigeria Governors Forum demonstrates a deep sense of solidarity through visits and statements that are quite reassuring. A case in point was the visit to the Niger State Governor at Minna, the state capital, when the massive school abduction occurred in February 2021. Such visits to other states have happened across the country in recent times.
Our peace in Bauchi is not just won just like that. It is something that is very deliberate. It's based on a policy thrust that we establish that security is the key to whatever we are going to do, so that we don't create a situation where farmers cannot go to the farm, hunters cannot go to hunt, and then school children cannot go to school. And of course, we have a joint patrol mechanism that we are doing with the army, with the police, even with the hunters.
One special measure among several that resonates with the governors is the need for the establishment of state police to complement the efforts of the federal police.
From what I have seen, before I came here, I came from the Senate. And while in the parliament, I was very strong in conversing for state governments to flood their own police.
The existing strength of the Nigerian police or the Nigerian army
is so inadequate. I know in Kaduna we don't have up to 3,000 policemen. Kaduna has a population of 78 million people. Just to buy 3,000 with even 7 million, you will come to over 210 to one policeman. So something fundamentally has to be done. The issue of not able to pay police is not true. The federal government has delved into issues that are purely local. So that's how our money is being frittered away.
There is perhaps no other greater concern for a people than health anywhere in the world. The destabilizing effect of the COVID-19 pandemic no doubt overwhelmed several other deadly diseases with lethal consequences, while malaria has continued to ravage the populace. Polio again reared its ugly head, to which the NGF responded to complement the federal government's efforts by mitigating the direct administration of vaccines to several communities, while also liaising with the international donor agencies to ensure that remedies penetrate the nooks and crannies of the country. The committee, headed by Governor Ifeanyi Okorwa of Delta State, himself a medical doctor, has recorded significant successes, with Nigeria eventually being certified polio-free. One other area some people are applauding the NGF is on how their intervention has significantly reduced the intensity of feud between labor unions and government at both state and federal levels.
What we try to do here now is that when money comes, we put it on the table. Let NSC be involved, let everybody be involved, share it. So when they shared, and for a particular month it was supposed to be 10%, I felt horrified. And I said, no, it cannot, it's not, it does not mean well. And I said, okay, whatever it take, I will borrow to increase that to 35%. Because I believe that a laborer or civil servant is entitled to his wage. I agree.
The cordiality between the Committee of Vice Chancellors of Nigerian Universities and the NGF further attest to the will to minimize incessant closure of universities, which results from trade disputes. In a rather reassuring manner, the NGF as a body has at every opportunity decried heating up the polity in the guise of agitation for self-determination by groups across the country. The forum has maintained that responsible dialogue through established channels holds greater prospects of achieving justice for all. The mischievous tendency by some citizens to ethnicize violence by ascribing dastardly acts to certain tribes and religion is something the body has also consistently condemned in unequivocal terms. Similarly, the issues of corruption, lack of accountability, electoral fraud, and management of the economy have continued to receive attention in the form of constructive criticism and advice. Perhaps of special note is a seemingly populist stance of the NGF in resisting a bogus payment in millions of dollars to consultants as fees for brokering recovery of funds for states.
This is just a ruse. That was a position. But how the so-called consultants were able to convince federal government and people were able to sign that they will now deduct money from us to pay them, we were shocked. That's why we are in court. We have told the federal government, you cannot pay this money. Who awarded this contract? What did they do for us? Absolutely nothing.
The matter has been left to the courts for adjudication. Finally, while the NGF as a body and by many actions of its members continue to emphasize our immense potential and the unity of Nigeria, it remains to be seen how the general public takes full advantage of their intervention to bring growth and development to the populace.
At the bottom of everything is the need for peace. So shooting for a violence-free society is the ultimate. And we're completely committed to it.